Now, after having understood the concept of stress strain curve, let us see what are the properties that we can obtain from a typical stress strain curve. Okay, the first one is Young's modulus or modulus of elasticity. So, if you observe the stress strain curve, it was a plot of stress versus strain. So, this was strain, this was stress. Of course, we used notation S because it was engineering stress. For strain, we used the small e, which was engineering strain. Now, the curve was a straight line initially, like this. Okay. Now, if you take the slope of this curve, okay, this slope is y by x. Okay, this slope is S divided by E. The slope of this is called Young's modulus or modulus of elasticity. So, therefore, E is given by sigma by epsilon or S by E. Both can be used because when the deformation is very small, both will give you the same answer. Therefore, you can as well write Young's modulus as E is equal to S by E. This is Young's modulus. So, from the Hooke's law also, you can derive this concept of Young's modulus as PL by delta A. Now, coming to the units of Young's modulus, okay. Young's modulus has got the same units as stress, that is Pascals or megapascals, because the strain, okay, the strain has no units. Therefore, the stress and Young's modulus will have same unit. Now, what is the use of this Young's modulus? Young's modulus will tell you about the stiffness of the material. Later you will see stiffness of a bar is given by E A by L. Okay, we'll study later. So, in this stiffness, Young's modulus is a material property that will determine the stiffness of the bar. Young's modulus is an important concept. It will tell you how the particular bar is going to deflect when subjected to load. And the Young's modulus or modulus of elasticity of steel is of order 200 to 210 GPa for structural steel. For aluminium, it is around 73 GPa, that is gigapascal. Giga means 10 power 9. So, G is 10 power 9. Okay, and for plastic such as epoxy, it can vary anywhere between 0.7 to 14 gigapascal. For example, epoxy has got around 3.4 gigapascal as its Young's modulus. Then comes the elastic limit. Elastic limit is by definition is a stress before which elastic deformation is seen. After the elastic limit is reached, you will find there is a plastic deformation or permanent deformation. As I said earlier, this is only of academic interest. Practically speaking, elastic limit is almost equal to proportional limit. Okay. Then we will see what is proportional limit. Proportional limit is a maximum stress at which the stress strain curve deviates from linearity. So, from 0 to this particular value of stress, the stress strain curve is linear, it is a straight line, and it is of course elastic because it is very much within the elastic limit. When you remove the load, it will come back to original position. In addition to being elastic, the ratio between stress and strain is constant, which we have seen it as nothing but a Young's modulus. So, up to this point, proportional limit, if you take a if I call this as a proportional limit, if you take slope anywhere on this line, you will get the same slope, which is nothing but Young's modulus. So, proportional limit is the stress below which the ratio of stress by strain is constant. In other words, the Young's modulus is constant in this region. So, this proportional limit is a useful quantity because it will tell you the elastic limit also, because as I said earlier, proportional limit is almost equal to elastic limit. Therefore, most of the time from the graph, we will just find out proportional limit and assume the same value for elastic limit. So, after the proportional limit, the curve starts to deviate. Instead of straight line, now it becomes a curved line. So, that is the differentiation between linearity and non-linearity is seen from proportional limit curve. Now, the value of proportional limit can vary for low carbon steel from 210 to 350 megapascal, and for high strength steel, that is when you have carbon and other alloy or other contents inside, and it becomes an alloy of steel, it can go up to 550 megapascal. So, up to 550 megapascal, it can behave in a linear elastic manner. Now comes the concept of yield stress or yield point given by the notation sigma yp. Sometimes they'll simply say sigma y. Both mean same thing, it is yield point stress or yield stress. So by definition, yield stress is a stress at which a plastic deformation, a permanent deformation starts to occur. Okay. For example, for structural steel, it is 250 megapascal. It's megapascal, I should have written MPa. 250 megapascal. For high carbon steels, it is 700 megapascal. Now, by definition, up to, for example, for structural steel, up to 250, you will find there is no permanent deformation observed in the material. So, when you remove the load, all the deformation comes back and material behaves as if there was no deformation. But once you reach this stress of say 250 megapascal for structural steel, then the deformation continues to occur even when you are not increasing any load, as we discussed in the earlier classes. So, this is your yield point. Yield point is a stress at which the continuous or considerable deformation is seen without any increase in the stress. Please remember, I am repeating once again, there is no increase in the stress. It doesn't mean there is no stress. There is a stress. Only thing is it remains constant. Even at constant stress, you will find there is a deformation occurring continuously to certain point called D, from where the strain hardening starts. So, yield point is an important phenomena because the most of the designs are based on yield point only, because after yield point, the material deformation becomes large and we don't want the deformation in many cases. So, we limit our designs mostly to yield point. Then we have ultimate stress, the maximum stress the material can bear before its failure is ultimate stress. Please remember, ultimate stress is calculated as the maximum load divided by initial area. So, it is not the actual area. So, sigma u, ultimate stress is P max, that is a maximum or ultimate stress divided by A0, that is initial area. So, it is a maximum stress a material can bear before the failure. And on the stress strain curve, this is the highest point. And around this point, you will see there is a lot of necking occurring, and in a couple of minutes, you will find it is reaching the fractional stress and failing. This ultimate stress for structural steel is around 400 to 550 megapascal. Please remember, steel comes in many varieties. As you keep on changing the carbon content and other elements, chemical elements, the properties keep on changing. This is roughly a guidance value. Okay. And then we have what is known as fracture stress, the stress at fracture. Just a few milliseconds before the failure, whatever stress exists in the component, that you known as fracture stress. Sometimes we can use fracture stress for design. Sometimes we can use yield stress for design, depending on our requirement. If I don't want any deformation in the component, then I will go for a yield point. Okay. The moment the stress reaches yield point, I will have to stop. Whereas sometimes I'm okay if I'm creating a say missile, it's okay if it deforms. Finally, it should take the load beyond deformation also, because even if it fractures also, I'm not bothered once it does its job. Therefore, for design of such things, we'll go for fracture stress. That is a stress before the failure. Now we will see a property of the materials called ductility. As its ductility is the ability to deform without fracture. That means whatever deformation that occurs before fracture is observed, and based on this deformation will characterize the material as ductile material and brittle material. Suppose when I say ductile material, the material undergoes large deformation before the failure, then we say it is a ductile material. If the deformation is very small, then we will say it is brittle material. Okay. Now, how to characterize this ductility? Ductility is characterized by two parameters. One is percentage elongation, another one is percent reduction in area. Percent elongation means initially it was of some certain length, say 1 meter. After the failure, it has reached say 1.2 meter. So, that 2 meter, 0.2 meter is a deformation that will characterize this percent elongation. So, during the testing of the material, we have seen the length of the specimen increases, okay, till fracture. However, the diameter keeps on decreasing. Okay, observe these two phenomena. The length is increasing, whereas the diameter is decreasing. So, we define the quantity called percent elongation as L1 minus L0 by L0 into 100. So, this L1 is the final distance, okay, before the fracture. Okay, suppose if it was 1 meter initially and it has become 1.2 meter just before the fracture. So, this L1 refers to 1.2 meter. So, here L0 is your original length. So, final length minus original length will give you the total deformation of the material divided by the original length will give you into 100 will give you percentage elongation. So, please remember this L1 is the final length whereas L0 is the initial length. So, we don't want this to be a negative quantity. Therefore, L1 being a bigger always, okay, we will write L1 minus L0 by L0 into 100. So, for structural steel, we will find out from experiment that it is around 20 to 30%. The percent elongation when calculated for aluminium alloys, it will be around 1% to 45% depending on this composition. Okay. Now, we will define the second quantity called percent reduction in area. So, as we observed already, when the load is increased, when the length increases, simultaneously the diameter increases. So, we want to know how much diameter is decreasing throughout the test. Now, the percent reduction in area, see the word reduction, okay. Here it is elongation, whereas here it is reduction. So, here we write it as A0 minus A1 divided by A0 into 100. Now, A0 is the initial cross-section area, okay, and A1 is the final cross-section area. Look at this, here we have written final minus initial, here we are writing initial minus final, only because we don't want this to be a negative quantity, because initial area of cross-section is always more than the final area of cross-section, because during the testing, the area of cross-section is reducing. Therefore, we write A0 minus A1 divided by A0 into 100. This will give you percentage reduction in area. So, this is delta A, you can say delta A, that is change in cross-sectional area divided by the initial area into 100 will give me the percentage reduction in area. Another important property that can be obtained from the stress strain curve is resilience. Resilience is the ability of material to absorb energy when it is deformed elastically and release that energy upon unloading. In other words, resilience represents the ability of material to absorb and release energy within the elastic range. Now, where is this energy coming from is the question. Now, when you take a bar like this, when you take a bar, okay, and you apply certain load, you are applying a load P, and because of load it deforms, okay, the length increases as seen in the dotted line. So let us say this is a delta. Okay, now while pulling you are applying a force and this force is moving over a distance delta and you are doing a work. So whatever work is done in pulling that body, increasing its length, will be stored inside the body as strain energy. So, energy, this is the energy that is stored in the material comes basically from the external load that you are applying. So, for example, if I am pulling a bar, I am doing some work, I am transferring energy to generate that force and that force will stretch the bar. And whatever work is done by this force will be stored inside the body as strain energy. Now, to characterize this energy stored, we'll use a term called modulus of resilience. So, modulus of resilience is the it's not energy, it is energy per unit volume. That means I'll just take a bar and find out whatever energy it has and divided by the, so if it has got a certain energy E and divided by the volume, I'll get energy per unit volume. So that will be your modulus of resilience. So by definition, it is the strain energy stored per unit volume when a material is stressed from zero stress to yield point stress. So it is to be remembered, the stress that you are applying, okay, it is only up to elastic point or yield point, because elastic, proportional, yield point are more or less at same location. So, up to the elastic or proportional limit, we'll load it and then we'll observe how much energy it has got. So, that will give you the modulus of resilience. So, work done by the external force can be given by work is equal to force into distance. So imagine you are applying a force of P and it is deforming a body by an amount of delta. Now please remember, this delta is a finite deformation. Initially it was 0 and then it became 1 mm, 2 mm, finally it reached delta. So instead of taking complete delta, we will take the average deformation. That is, if it is 0 here, okay, if it is delta here, so if you take the average, 0 plus delta by 2, that will be the average deformation. So we will write work done as P into delta by 2. Okay, this is work, this is measured in joules. This is joules. Now this is also is equal to energy, because we will assume whatever work you are doing will be completely stored inside the body as strain energy. So work done by you will be stored inside the body as strain energy. Now our definition of model of resilience is not the energy stored, it is the energy stored per unit volume. So we have to divide this by volume. Okay, now let me say modulus of resilience. So, sorry, let me erase this. I'll write here. Okay, I'll write UR, small UR, energy, the modulus of resilience is equal to total energy stored by the body divided by the volume. Volume can be written as area into length. Okay, I'll write A into length. Okay, so I'll replace the expression for energy as 1 by 2 into P into delta divided by A by L. Now we know that from definition of stress, P by A is your stress. Okay, this quantity is your stress sigma. And this deformation by initial length, so this delta by L will be your strain, so this will be epsilon. Okay, therefore the modulus of resilience is given by half into sigma into epsilon. That's what I have written here. Okay, this is half into sigma into strain is your modulus of resilience. By definition, model of resilience is to be the energy only up to the elastic limit or yield point. Therefore, I will substitute sigma yield point and strain here. When I substitute, I will get an expression for modulus of resilience as sigma square yp by 2e. That is an expression for modulus of resilience. Next quantity is toughness. Toughness is similar to resilience. Only difference is, if you are considering the energy stored per unit volume till the failure, till the rupture, then you will call it as toughness. Toughness represents the ability of material to absorb energy till failure. Some material may fail by absorbing only small amount of energy. Those are called less tough materials. Whereas some other materials, usually the ductile materials, can store large amount of energy before the failure. Such materials will call it as it has got high toughness. So the toughness refers to the ability of material to absorb energy without fracturing. So before fracture, whatever energy this body absorbs is your toughness. But toughness is measured in terms of modulus of toughness, something like a modulus of rigidity that you have studied earlier. So this is given by the area under this curve. So I forgot to mention that here also, from this diagram you see half sigma e is your modulus of resilience, right? So this is nothing but the area under this curve up to this point. So this height is sigma, the horizontal length is epsilon. So area of this triangle will be half into base into height. That is nothing but half into epsilon into sigma, which is nothing but modulus of resilience. So modulus of resilience is nothing but area of the stress strain curve up to the yield point or proportional limit. Whereas the modulus of toughness is the area of the stress strain curve up to the rupture. So obviously the energy stored in the body up to rupture is more than the energy stored in the body till yield point. Okay, the modulus of toughness will usually be more than the modulus of resilience. Now once again, let me tell the difference between this modulus of resilience and modulus of toughness. Model of resilience refers to the energy stored per unit volume when the stress is only up to yield point or elastic limit, whereas modulus of toughness refers to the energy per unit volume when you are loading up to the fracture. Okay, that's the difference. Okay, once again, we'll see what is this ductility. As already discussed, ductility refers to the ability of the material to undergo large deformation before failure. After the failure, if you observe that particular material has undergone large deformation, the deformation is very large, we'll say this material is a ductile material. So instead, if you find that the deformation is very small, okay, just going say let's 1 mm, within 1 mm it has broken into two parts, then we'll say it's a brittle material. There are what is the advantage of this ductility? Ductility will help to bend a bar into a circular arc, okay, without breaking. And advantage of this is it will give you a visible distortion if certain component is made of ductile material. So as the stress increases, it will lead to the change in the deformation, in the sense increase in the deformation. So when the deformation is large, one can easily see it, and if you find that there is a deformation, you can understand that the stress is also more, you can immediately replace the material. So that way you can prevent the failure by observing the large deformation. Similarly, because it's a ductile, it, as we have seen in the earlier definition of modulus of toughness, it can store large amount of strain energy. Storing strain, a large amount of energy, will ensure that material will not fail quickly. There are some examples of ductile material like steel, aluminium, copper, magnesium, bronze. All this will come under ductile materials. Now, one important observation to be seen from the ductile materials such as structural steel is, in materials like steel, the ductile, yield point is clearly visible. As you can see from this diagram, the point A is your yield point. It's very clear. So, say, for example, in this case, let us say 35 pounds per square inch is your yield point. I can easily identify. Whereas there are certain ductile materials like aluminium, whose stress strain curve is not very clear like this. This is the right hand diagram. Okay, this diagram represents the stress strain curve for a aluminium alloy. Now here I cannot tell where exactly the yielding has started. Okay, so for that, to find out the yield point, there is no clearly defined yield point. So therefore, what engineers do is they will make an approximation to find out the yield point. To define that, they'll introduce a new concept called offset yield strength or proof stress. Here what we do is, for those materials which do not have a clearly defined yield point, we will try to draw a line parallel to the initial line. Okay, how much with an offset? Okay, what is an offset? We will say we can draw this parallel line here, like this. You can draw anywhere. Okay, but scientists say, out of experience, if the strain is at 0.2%, please remember it is not 2%, it is 0.2%. So that means 2/1000 is your strain value. So you identify a point somewhere here which has got a strain value of 0.2% or 2/1000. From there you draw a straight line which is parallel to the initial portion of the stress strain curve. When this line cuts at a point A, the corresponding stress value, okay, whatever stress you will find out, this will be your offset yield point or offset stress. Sometimes in United Kingdom they may also call this as proof stress. And the strain, here we have taken 0.2, they may say 0.15% or 0.1% may be fixed. Okay, usually this is the most popular one. The 0.2% strain is most popular, and corresponding stress will be your yield point stress. Of course, this is not a fundamental material property. It is an, a convenient property that we defined for our practical usage. Okay, some value we want to have, reliable value. Now we will look into what is known as brittleness. Materials that fail in tension at relatively low values of strain are called brittle materials. Unlike a ductile material, these materials do not have a yield point. Okay, and the differentiation that we had, like ultimate stress and fracture stress, are not available because the curve is no longer a bent curve. It is straight away. You will go reach from point O to A, and then B, it will fracture at point B. because the deformation is small, when it has fractured, you can reassemble them and you will get the original shape almost of same size. Because the deformation is very small, no? You can get the original matter, original material itself. And these deformations are not plastic deformations, they are not permanent deformations. They will deform and then cut. Once it is cut, then no question of deformation at all. The examples of brittle material include concrete, stone, cast iron, glass and ceramic and many other metallic alloys. Now let's look at the stress strain diagram of a material called rubber. So you will find rubber in two forms. One is hard rubber, another one is soft rubber. In hard rubber, you will find the deformations are small, relatively small, and the stress strain curve is more or less straight line. It's a linear in nature. And of course, it is elastic. That means when you unload it, the entire deformation is regained. When it comes to soft rubber, the deformation is very large, almost 8 times the initial length. It has extended by that much large. I mean, the soft rubber is has extended by a large amount. In case of soft rubber, you will see the deformation is very large. No, it has extended by almost 8 times. And this soft rubber is also elastic in the sense when you unload it, it will come back to the original shape without any permanent deformations. You can test this by using ordinary rubber band that you have with you. But the question is rubber a brittle or ductile material? Rubber is actually a brittle material because even though the deformations are large, but these deformations are not plastic in nature. These are not permanent deformations. Therefore, it is called elastic but ductile, sorry, elastic but brittle material.